The Trail of Tears. The year was 1838, and Native Americans from the Southeast were being forcibly removed from their ancestral homelands. Several thousand Cherokees would die along this journey before reaching their new home west of the Mississippi River. But who forced them to leave, and why? Well, let's find out. At the time of this case, the Cherokee Nation owned territory within the borders of North Carolina, Alabama, Tennessee, and Georgia. But the states wanted this land. Samuel Worcester, a minister from Vermont, was sent as a missionary to live amongst the Cherokee people in New Echota, their national capital. While Worcester helped translate the Bible into their native language, he also advised the Cherokee leaders of their political and legal rights. New Echota was located within the boundaries of the state of Georgia, so the Georgia legislature enacted a law that prohibited white persons from living on Cherokee land without permission from the state.
They didn't like the missionaries?
The state recognized that Worcester was influential in the Cherokee resistance movement, so they ordered Worcester and his fellow missionaries to leave the state unless they could somehow obtain a license to be there.
Right. Like that would happen. So, what did the missionaries do?
The missionaries refused to apply for a license and refused to leave. So, they were arrested.
Wow, the state really didn't like them much, did they?
I don't know how personal it was, but they certainly did not like him standing in their way. What happened next, though, was the first step in defining what this case was really about. Worcester's lawyers argued that because he served as a federal postmaster at New Echota, he was in the Cherokee Nation under the authority of the federal government.
Clever. So, he was released?
He was, but then Georgia's governor, George R. Gilmer, persuaded the U.S. government to relieve Worcester of his postmaster duties.
So, he was arrested again?
Yes, along with 9 other missionaries who refused to leave the Cherokee. But it wasn't long before Worcester posted bond and was released.
For good this time?
No.
This is starting to sound like bullying. I don't like bullies. But I've learned when you're bullied, you can just turn and walk away. So why didn't Worcester just leave the state?
Well, he believed in what he was doing. Also, during the time Worcester was being bullied, his daughter became ill and passed away.
Oh, that's terrible.
It was, and when Worcester went home to comfort his wife, the Georgia Guard arrested him for the 3rd time.
Are you kidding me? For living on Cherokee land?
It was against the law.
But it sure seemed like the state of Georgia was playing games with him.
And they were just getting started. After a temporary release to console his wife, Worcester and the other missionaries were tried, convicted, and sentenced to hard labor for 4 years in the Georgia penitentiary. But the missionaries appealed their case to the U.S. Supreme Court.
I love those guys. What did the Supreme Court say?
Well, before I tell you their decision, let's back up a little bit and fill in some other historic details you should probably know.
Okay.
In 1827, the Cherokees established their own constitutional government. By doing so, they were not only restructuring their government, but also declaring that they were a sovereign nation and could not be removed without their consent. The Georgia legislature responded by annexing the Cherokee lands.
Wait, what does it mean to annex their land?
They took it, legally. They also abolished their government, courts, and laws.
Wow.
They also created a standard process for seizing the Cherokee land and distributing it to the state of Georgia's white citizens.
Could they do that?
Well, they tried. Representatives from Georgia and the other southern states pushed the Indian Removal Act through Congress in 1830.
What was that?
The Indian Removal Act gave U.S. President Andrew Jackson the authority to negotiate removal treaties with Native Americans.
And did he?
Did he what?
Did Andrew Jackson negotiate a removal treaty with the Native Americans?
Yes, he did, in 1835. after the Supreme Court struck down Georgia's new laws.
Wait, so the President of the United States ignored the Supreme Court?
Well, let's just say he didn't enforce their decision.
Which was?
Why don't we let Supreme Court Justice Marshall tell you in his own words?
The Cherokee Nation is a distinct community, occupying its own territory in which the laws of Georgia can have no force.
He also wrote that the Indian nations were
distinct, independent political communities retaining their original natural rights.
Then he pointed to several treaties where the United States had acknowledged this point.
Acknowledged what?
The Cherokee Indians constituted a nation holding distinct sovereign powers.
In English, please.
The state of Georgia had no jurisdiction over the Cherokee Nation.
Even though they were located within the state borders?
Exactly.
So, what happened next?
Well, Georgia ignored the Supreme Court's ruling, refused to release the missionaries, and continued to press the federal government to remove the Cherokees.
And President Jackson did nothing to enforce the decision?
Nope. In fact, President Jackson summarized his position in a letter to Brigadier General John Coffey.
The decision of the Supreme Court has fell stillborn, and they find it cannot coerce Georgia to yield its mandate.
In other words, we're not helping.
Exactly. Except he did negotiate the removal treaty with the Cherokees I mentioned earlier.
Which led to the Trail of Tears?
Yes, because the Cherokees were reluctant to leave their homeland, the U.S. Army had to forcibly remove and march them to their new territory in present-day Oklahoma.
And what happened to Worcester?
He and the other missionaries accepted a pardon from Georgia's new governor, Wilson Lumpkin, who was receiving intense criticism for the imprisonment of the missionaries. In exchange for their pardon, the missionaries abandoned their Cherokee campaign and were released from prison in 1833.
So, their mission failed?
Well, not exactly. Despite the dismal aftermath, the decision of the court became the foundation for the principle of tribal sovereignty in the 20th century.
I see.
The Supreme Court's decision became a powerful declaration used by the Indian nations to defend themselves against state and local encroachments on their tribal lands. It also reminded the federal government that the tribe's dependence on the United States for protection meant that the federal government has moral obligations of the highest responsibility and trust when it deals with the Indian tribes.
Cool. What case should we learn about next?
It's up to them.